Okay, we're ready to begin. Thank you all for coming. Hugo and I would like to have a semblance of a real class, but we understand as well if you can't make it on some days. I will always record our sessions and drop them into studio, but I think it's important that we have this kind of interactive session. You know, I don't want to be reduced by technology into a YouTube link, and I'm just so happy that so many have joined us today. Okay, we're going to continue our lectures that are stored in my ethics class and on Canvas. And today we're going to do plagiarism, and then on Wednesday we're going to do invention. Both of those topics are intertwined. I also posted a schedule on the announcements. We'll try to stick to that, maybe go a little bit faster than that schedule so we can have some time for the final exam. And the final exam can be taken remotely, and we'll explain that as we get closer to it. Okay, plagiarism. We're going to start today with I am so happy to see everyone. We're going to start today with an anecdote from my son, who was 12 years old at the time, my son Mikhail. And we went into the pharmacy. We were waiting for some medication. And there was a little sign, and the sign said, "Can you guess how many pills are in this bottle? And if you can, you can win a prize." So I, you know, explained to Mikhail how to figure out the volume, how to multiply the base times the height, and he listened intently, I thought, and then he said, "Dad, can I have your cell phone?" So I figured, okay, he wants to access my computer function. And then within a few seconds, he wrote a number down and he deposited it in that little hole there. And what he did was he went online, he looked up the bottle there, and he figured out how many pills by the description online, and he put that in the in the tube. And I wouldn't let him win a prize, and I get some guff for that because he didn't figure it mathematically. But this is the issue of internet and all the ways that internet has changed everyday life. And when we look at plagiarism, it does have a particular strong role in it. So we're going to continue with some, and I call this illiteracy. Many people are illiterate, and I mean that they have electronic literacy. But the critical thinking part sometimes goes by the wayside. And when we're dealing with plagiarism, this really comes into stark focus. So I want to go to some basic definitions of plagiarism so that we're all on the same page. And we're going to go ahead and annotate this. So the definition of plagiarism is stealing or closely imitating anyone else's written, creative, electronic, photograph, tape, promotional, research work, essentially anything. When we take a look at technology, often what we're saying with plagiarism is in journalism, but it's not true. You can steal advertising research. You can steal campaign design. Theft goes on all the time, and that's why we want to take a close look at it across our majors. Now, in ethical language, the source document is that document or design that that it's original and that has a copyright to it, but we're going to steal. That's the source document. And when we steal it, we upload it into the target document. So when you're talking about plagiarism, it's good to know these two terms. Well, where did you get that source document from? And the target document is suspect. Now, there are legal and ethical considerations when we look at intent. The legal definition of plagiarism is doesn't care whether you knew it was wrong or whether you didn't know it was wrong. In law, intent doesn't matter. So in other words, if you steal something, and we're going to talk a little bit more about this later, you're not only liable for the plagiarism part. If you steal enough of it, you're into copyright infringement. And copyright infringement is a very serious thing. Now, ethically, we can say, well, didn't you know it was wrong to take those words and pass them off as your own. And often we hear, I didn't know it was wrong. When you say, I didn't know it was wrong, and you start talking about your intent, then suddenly you're in the area of plausible deniability. In other words, if I can't get into your mind, then I can't actually know whether you are committing a deceit or not by stealing those words. So we're going to go and take a look at a very famous case of plagiarism, and then we're going to take a look at plausible deniability again. So let's play this tape with Melania Trump.
Barack and I were raised with so many of the same values, like you work hard for what you want in life, that your word is your bond, that you do what you say you're going to do.
My parents impressed on me the value that you work hard for what you want in life, that your word is your bond, and you do what you say and keep your promise.
That you treat people with dignity and respect, even if you don't know them, and even if you don't agree with them.
That you treat people with respect. They taught and showed me values and morals in their daily life. That is a lesson that I continue to pass along to our son. And we need to pass those lessons on to the many generations to follow.
And Barack and I set out to build lives guided by these values and to pass them on to the next generation, because we want our children and all children in this nation to know that the only limit to the height of your achievements is the reach of your dreams and your willingness to work hard for them.
Because we want our children in this nation to know that the only limit to your achievements is the strength of your dreams and your willingness to work for them.
Well, the interesting thing there, it was a speech. Now, here's the backstory to it. We're going to look at plausible deniability in a minute. But the interesting thing here is that when this became a news story, the Trump administration blamed the speechwriter, a public relations practitioner, and the speechwriter said that she took Obama, Melania Trump admired Michelle Obama, so she went back to her speeches and she failed to attribute it. And that was the official line after this happened. But soon after it happened, we get into Paul Manafort, who I believe right now is in federal prison, but he was the campaign manager then. And listen to what he says.
Who takes the fall for cribbing Michelle Obama's speech in 2008? Whose fault is that?
Well, there's no cribbing of Michelle Obama's speech. These were common words and values, and she cares about her family, that things like that. I mean, she was speaking in front of 35 million people last night. She knew that. To think that she would be cribbing Michelle Obama's words is crazy. This is once again an example of when a woman threatens Hillary Clinton, seeks out to demean her and take her down. It's not going to work.
All I'm saying is the language is strikingly similar. I'm not making a big deal of it. I know everybody's talking about it this morning, but I don't think it's an allegation. It's not some suggestion without proof. I think it happened. I don't understand why the campaign doesn't just own it and say people borrow phrases. That's what happened and moved on. That's what, ironically, Obama did in 2008 when Clinton said that he cribbed from Deval Patrick. He said, yeah, you're right, I did it.
He did do it. That's correct. But in this particular case, there was certainly a collaboration. Certainly there's no feeling by her on her part that she did it. What she did was use words that are common words. And Just to expect her to think that she would do something like that, knowing how scrutinized her speech was going to be last night, is just really absurd.
Okay, so what you have heard here is an example not only of gaslighting, but of plausible deniability. These are common words, it's just a coincidence, and so forth. So here I put on your lecture side by side so that you can see how similar and exact those words are. Okay, now, before there was technology, when you accused somebody, if you were a teacher and you accused a student of plagiarism or a reporter of plagiarism, they would say, it's only a coincidence. Okay, so I want to talk about the coincidence factor so that you know if this ever happens to you, how to dismiss it. I'm going to tell you another story that happened in my magazine class. The writer was Andrea Tortora. At the time, she was also editor of The Post, which is the student newspaper at Ohio University. But she was in my magazine class. And she wrote a piece for editor and publisher. It was actually published in March of that semester about how it feels to be a student editor. So these are the words that she wrote. 64 words, I believe. For the past 10 months, I've been racist, homophobic, sexist, biased, and stupid. I've been exploitative and insensitive. I've been a college newspaper editor. At 22, I'm burnt out, hardened, exasperated. As the editor of The Post, a student newspaper at Ohio University, I've defended my writers, my editors, and my newspaper to its patrons, many who do not understand journalism and its principles. Well, what happened here was, a month later, the editor of a rival student newspaper at another Ohio university wrote an op-ed that had those exact same words. I was the ethics teacher at the time at Ohio and also the magazine instructor, and Andrea came to me and said, what should I do? So I said, well, let's contact him. Let's call him up and let's see if he could admit it and run a retraction. So we ended up calling him, and he said, oh, it was just a coincidence, plausible deniability, just like Paul Manafort did. So we buckled down, and we went to a mathematician at Ohio University, and the statistical odds of that happening is, if you take a conservative figure, like 800,000 words in the English language, and that's very conservative, because if you add slang and you add colloquialisms, it's more like 1.5 million words. But let's just take a standard conservative, it's 800,000 words in the English dictionary. That would be to the 64th power. That's a lot of zeros behind that. So we created this little matrix, which you can always use, just to show how it's called the statistical odds of coincidence. So if you're using a word like allow, that gets a number, like number one. If you're using a variant of that word, like allowing, that gets another, it's a fraction, or allows, that gets another fraction. And each time that a word is used, it gets that number. So if you take a look now at the statistical odds of coincidence, and I'm going to go ahead and annotate that as well. If you take a look now at this key, which I have here, imagine having a lottery ticket in which you not only have to have all of the words in sequence, but you also have to have recurring words, like the article V would recur here and here and here and so on. The fact of the matter is that the English language is such a complex language that the statistical odds of probability are extraordinarily low. So when we went to the mathematician, he said that there's really hardly enough time in the universe for that coincidence to happen. And if we're looking at an entire article that's plagiarized, you're looking at not enough time in the universe for that to happen. You often heard of the saying that if you put enough monkeys in the room with typewriters, that the monkeys would eventually type out a Shakespeare play. That's not true. The statistical odds of improbability are vast in order to do something of that nature. So we use this little formula to undermine anybody that says, oh, it's a coincidence. Now, this story with Andrea Totora goes on a little bit more. I want to talk to you about another concept of negligence before we continue this case study. If someone says, for instance, I didn't know that copying and pasting and passing off as my own was a problem, nobody ever taught me that, then you have to bring up the concept of negligence. And what that means is, let me understand this. You were given a writing assignment and all you did was copy, select, and paste, and that's not wrong. The whole idea of negligence is a much more serious firing offense in many shops. Negligence makes you personally liable. Let's go back to Andrea Totora, and I want to tell you what happens. I think it was a year and a half after the incident. Now remember, Andrea wrote for my magazine class, was also the editor of the Post, and she wrote this lead that was pilfered by the editor of a rival newspaper. And lo and behold, a little bit later, she's working in the newsroom of the Cincinnati Enquirer. And who walks in for a finalist interview to work at the Enquirer but the editor who originally stole her work? So this is one of those things where what should Andrea do? If anybody wants to say what you would do, just put on your mic and your video and let us know. We'll wait about 10 seconds, and if nobody wants to do that, we'll just continue the lecture. What would you do if you were Andrea? Okay, no takers. That's okay. But I want to make a point here. And I'll put myself on full screen here. Whether we're talking about plagiarism, about racism, sexism, any of the isms, it's not really about whether you would commit a plagiarism, whether you are racist. You would say, no, I don't have a racist bone in my body. You've heard that saying before. The problem is it's usually associated with the mouth. Just keep in mind, it's not about that. It's about what you would do if you witnessed it. What would you do if you witnessed plagiarism the way Andrea Totora did? What would you do if you witnessed sexism or racism in the newsroom or in the boardroom? What would you do? So that's going to be an important factor in all of our discussions. So what she did was, actually, she didn't do nothing at first, and then the candidate came to her and said, look, I know what happened. I'm sorry about what happened, but I want to know if you would be able to work with me. And Andrea said, and I was very proud of her, she said, yeah, I'll be able to work with you, but I'm always going to watch you. And if you ever do anything like that again, I'm going to report it. Turns out the fellow didn't get the job, but I thought Andrea handled that well. And it's a good lesson for all of us to consider. Now, I want to go up a little bit, down a little bit further, and I want to focus on something here. These are terms that often are confused with plagiarism. So one of the terms is copyright infringement. If you plagiarize, or if someone plagiarizes a substantial portion of a work, you not only can be accused of plagiarism, which is one actionable account, but also copyright infringement, which is very serious. Now, I'm going to give you some guidelines on this. And again, copyright infringement could be stealing a sales report. It doesn't have to be journalism. I'm going to give you some guidelines on this. Even if you cite the source, you typically should not use more than 5% of any article, even one line of poetry or lyrics, you usually have to get permission. No more than 250 words of a book length source document. That's even if you cite them. Now, you can paraphrase their direct quotes, and then you can use a little bit more. But it's important to understand that copyright is a very important aspect of public relations, advertising, and journalism. There's another concept called proxy plagiarism. Proxy plagiarism is when you write something for someone else. Sometimes it's also known as reverse plagiarism. Let's say that we had an essay assignment in media ethics, and your roommate is also a member of my class, and she or he asks you, I can't get this paper done. Can you write it for me so I could put my name on it? That would be called proxy plagiarism. And if you buy an online paper, that's proxy plagiarism or reverse plagiarism too. Now, matching story is something that we all have to think about. In public relations, it's usually matching a campaign, advertising, matching a clever use of copywriting or visuals in an ad. And that happens infrequently. It does happen in advertising and public relations, but matching story happens on a regular, and I would say almost daily basis, on competing newspapers, broadcast stations, and online publications. So we're going to take a little closer look at that in a moment. And then there is a hoax, and the hoax is something that we covered in the last lecture. We're going to talk about invention on Wednesday. But I do want to take some time for our journalism members and talk about how to ethically match a story. So number one, never use the research or quotations from a source story. You want to match those. So if you're trying to match a story where three people were interviewed, you got to re-interview those people again. You just can't use someone else's interview. And don't think, and I know you do this, but sometimes lazy reporters will hide their deceit by making a direct quotation into an indirect quotation. Don't do that. You didn't interview the source. And I always would tell my reporters to interview one more source that your competitor doesn't have. Put that on the top of the story. So you don't want to use the research or quotations from another story. You never want to hide a quotation by making it indirect. And you're matching a story, you do not use a byline. And also, don't pretend to be in another city. And I'll give you an example of that. So if you're matching a story that happened in Iowa City and you're in Ames, you can't use an Iowa City dateline. That's called a magic carpet ride. And one more thing. If one of your sources had said something in a speech, let's say, you can't lift those remarks in a speech and cast them as quotations, as if the person was talking to an interview. I think all of you know that, but it's good for me to go over it. And then we get don't invent quotations, don't lift quotations, don't excerpt passages, things that we just covered. I want to talk a bit about content posted on social media. The Daily actually did two interviews with me this semester on TikTok and TikTok's terms of service, which are, TikTok just wants everything. When you agree to post a video loop on TikTok, you are agreeing that they can go into your phone, they can look at all your text messages and all your emails. Now, what they'll tell you in TikTok is they're doing this so that they can bend advertising according to your tastes. So this is concerning to me. If you're a videographer, when you are posting on TikTok, you not only lose rights to your copyright, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that in a second, but you lose what's called moral rights. Now, moral rights are very important for photographers, for artists, for illustrators, and for videographers, because that means if you post something on Instagram, Facebook, or TikTok, anybody, that company can actually take that content, manipulate it, and use it in any way they wish. And you can't claim that destroys my artistic creation because you've given up moral rights. Now, they'll tell you in Instagram and in Facebook and in TikTok and many in Twitter that you own the copyright to that material. Yeah, you own it, but you're also granting to the social media, you're granting them non-exclusive rights to do whatever they really want with that that content. And this is very concerning to me when we are looking at photography in particular. And I know without calling on the people in class, I know three people in class have side businesses that involve photography. And when you post your photos on the social media, they can use it in any way. So here is, I put a link here for those who are interested on how to protect your photos. You know, we want to do things like don't use a large JPEG, because if you use a large JPEG, for instance, they can take your photo and use it for greeting cards. They can put it on T-shirts. They can make screen savers and sell them. So you want to use a lower pixel file for something like that. Now, I want you to keep in mind that designs, and this pertains to advertising and public relations often in magazine journalism, designs and visuals also can be copyrighted and stolen. So we'll play a little video here for you.
It's not an illusion. With 2 million blog posts, 47 billion minutes spent on Facebook, 530 million statuses updated, and 860,000 hours of video uploaded to YouTube every day, it's no surprise that plagiarized content has risen to an enormous 63%. Cheating is contagious. Are you a follower? Idea theft has escalated and let the burst out of the bottle. Plagiarism has risen by 55%. 82% of students admit to engaging in some form of cheating. It's robbing people of their ideas, opinions, and creative expressions. Ideas are no longer original. They have just been repackaged, given a new identity and a new name. Not loving it.
The cockiest never lay the best ideas. They rather hatch a plan to poach. Are you that type?
On average, 50% of designers have pirated type, and over 1 million users copy type illegally on a daily basis. Talk about a ripoff. We all know Google and the Google Doodle, but Noodle? Is this okay? And now? What about now? The wheel has turned and nothing is safe. The general rule on plagiarism is that 25% of your work is allowed to be plagiarized. Successful? It seems the only way to protect your work is through trademark, register, and copyright. Or is it? Short phrases cannot be copyrighted, just like your name, title, status, and even your face. Under Facebook's current terms, by posting pictures, videos, and statuses, you grant Facebook worldwide license to use your content. Facebook has specific bylaws that have to be adhered to. Certain faces are copyrighted. Who owns it now? So who is at fault for this unoriginal sin? Is it Wikipedia, with 11.2 million matches to plagiarized work? Facebook, with 1.1 billion users reposting statuses and images? Twitter, with 300 million users retweeting 500 million tweets daily? Pinterest, with 70 million users and 30 billion pins to date? Or the biggest culprit, YouTube, with 1 billion users and 4 billion videos watched daily? It all points to one thing. If it feels wrong, it probably is. Think different.
You know, I like that video because it talks about if it feels wrong, it probably is, and that goes to the conscience. This is a very problem. This next video is very problematic for me because it's not only about buying online papers. It not only rather stereotypes college students. It is I don't trust or believe this testimonial.
Being a college student can be extremely stressful. If you're going to school full-time and trying to carry a part-time job, or in some cases full-time, and on top of that, you're trying to keep up with a social life. So it can be a bit much. I had a massive party to go to, but I had a killer essay that I needed to write, and I also had to work. So I needed to prioritize, right? How could I possibly get all three done? That's where yoursaywriter.com came into play. One of my friends told me about it because she uses it maybe a little more than she should, but she always gets A's and she's always 100% satisfied with the entire transaction. So what it is this website that writes your essays for you, and it's a piece of cake. They're all U.S. graduates and they really know their stuff. It's about $23 a page, so at first you might be like, oh, maybe I shouldn't do this. But once you turn it in and get an A back, you will be glad that you did. So if you're tossing up in the air between a massive party, a really bad essay to write, and work, let yoursaywriter.com take care of one of those and free up your weekend a little bit. Check it out today, yoursaywriter.com.
You know, the reason why I know that that testimonial isn't real is because I looked up and several people were saying the same script. But that's an example of buying online papers. The final video we're going to take a look at today, to me, is very important. Music is very important to me, has always been very important to me. And it's important to many of you. The interesting thing is so many songs are plagiarized and so many hit songs that we think are original are plagiarized. I want to add a historical ethical note to this. We know big names like Elvis and so on that were icons of rock and roll, but many African American musicians of the 40s, 50s, and 60s were really the target of a lot of plagiarism. They were inspiring, but they inspired to such extent that their work was stolen. They never got credit for them. We're going to take a look a little at that. This is a video worth looking at for some of the big songs that were stolen. I'm going to try to scroll through it rather quickly, but I think it's important to know how music is stolen and that historic element of African American musicians and artists.
Good composers borrow, great composers steal. Composers get caught.
That's great. That's marvelous, isn't it?
Welcome to WatchMojo.com, and today we're counting down our picks for the top 10 rip-off songs. For this list, we'll be ignoring sample-heavy songs and focusing on hit tunes where the similarities spawn threats of legal action. Number 10, The Kinks, All Day and All of the Night versus The Doors, Hello, I Love You. Although The Doors guitarist Robbie Krieger denied his band copied the chord-driven main riff, the Kinks music publishers found these two singles were just a bit too similar. UK courts agreed, and so a deal was eventually struck, entitling the Kinks to a large share of Hello I Love You's British royalties.
I know you need love.
While it took them a long time to get caught, the rock icons were finally sued in 1985 for Whole Lotta Love's Whole Lotta Similarities to the Willie Dixon-penned Muddy Waters classic. Though things were eventually settled out of court, it wasn't the only time the British rockers were accused of borrowing material, as even Stairway to Heaven untainted by calls of plagiarism. Number 8, Joe Satriani, If I Could Fly, versus Coldplay, Viva. Satriani's case was later dismissed in 2009. Number 7, The Kinks' Picture Book versus Other Garden Never Got the Chance versus Green Day, Warning. And now, when Ray Parker Jr.'s theme for the Supernatural comedy came out, sounding suspiciously like I Want a New Drug, Lewis cried plagiarism. It was settled out of court almost a decade later, and when the news frontman spilled the beans on the confidential settlement on TV, Ray Parker Jr. turned the tables and sued Lewis in 2001. In a very odd move, John Fogerty was sued for sounding like himself.
He take a thunder from the mountain. He take a lightning from the sky.
As owner of CCR's song catalog and his label during his Creedence days, Fantasy Records claimed the old man down the road.
He make the barking of the house.
Citing different chords, keys, and more. Bridgeport Music also became involved due to claims, blurred lines, samples, Funkadelic's Sexy Wave.
I just want to say that I love your sexy way.
The Rolling Stones' The Last Time versus The Verve, Bittersweet Symphony.
Boy, that riff is just exact. Okay, so, that concludes our lecture on plagiarism. Now, if anybody would like to make a comment or have a question on anything that we've seen, you can turn on your mic and your video and you could let us know. We'll wait a few seconds. And again, it's okay if you don't. It's okay with me. I'm just so happy that you're here. I've missed you all so very much. Hugo, do you want to put on your video and add anything?
Yeah, give me one sec. Yeah, so everyone, I will be sending out an email to all of you and also the other section about sending in your links. Most of you have already done that. I appreciate that. Also, I appreciate your patience on waiting for the feedback. As you know, I'm also going through the transition with my classes, so it's getting a little time to adjust to that and replying the feedback to you guys. But I will be sending out a message to all of you who haven't sent me your links. Please send me those so then Dr. Bouget and I can start plotting the semester and how grading will work, given the whole circumstance. But please send me those links. Other than that, the portfolios that I've seen and that I've given feedback to, is I told Dr. B, some of the most amazing portfolios I've seen, a lot better than mine. I can truly honestly say that. And you guys really, up the bar this year. So I appreciate you guys with patience, and also just be on the lookout for feedback. And then Dr. B and I will discuss how the rest of the semester's grades will be going. We're trying to transition into that. So if you guys have any questions, just email Dr. B or I, and we're happy to help.
Thank you, Hugo. And thank you all for showing up. More than half the class showed up. It's important, I think, that we maintain some sort of synchronicity, but keep in mind that I'm recording this session and I'm going to drop it in studio under plagiarism section 2. All of you take care, regards to your families, And don't worry about your grades. Hugo and I know that this is a burden for many of you. We're going to make it, and we have extra credit that we've explained in an email. So thank you. Enjoy your day. Have a wonderful day.